Hello everyone, my name is François Chasset. I'm dermatologist working in Tenon Hospital in Paris. Today, I'm glad to talk about the recent advances in the treatment of cutaneous lupus. We will talk about the different way to assess cutaneous activity, and then we'll talk about different things to treat CLE, from prevention to the future treatment of CLE. The overall general tools such as SLEDAI and BILAG are not correctly developed to correctly assess the cutaneous activity of CLE, and therefore a specific tool, the CLASI, Cutaneous Lupus Activity Score, has been developed to assess the activity of lupus with the erythema and the squale, and this score is able to classify the severity of lupus from mild disease from 0 to 9, moderate activity from 10 to 20, and severe activity from CLASI score higher than 21. This score is also able to measure the response, with a partial response defined as an improvement of 50% of CLASI activity, with a baseline CLASI from most of time 8 points. A major unmet need is that it is very important to consider the subtype when you want to treat a patient with CLE. Indeed, in the left part of the screen, you have this young patient with acute CLE with non-scarring alopecia. And as you can see, several months after, the hair regrowth is perfect and there is no lesion. But on the right part of the screen, you have this very severe discoid lupus erythematosus associated with high scarring rates and extensive skin damage, which may have major impact on quality of life, and therefore this subtype of patient may need more aggressive treatments. There is a major role of preventive measures. The first one is the photoprotection. Indeed, a randomized controlled trial demonstrated the efficacy of large broad spectrum sunscreen to prevent the induced cutaneous lesions. And a randomized control trial showed in healthy control that vitamin D is able to promote photoprotection as well. Smoking cessation is very important in cutaneous lupus. Indeed, CLE patients who are smoking have more severe disease, as you can see in this study from Piet et al., and are more resistant to antimalarials and as well to belimumab and lenalidomide. We will see this just after. It is important to consider drug-induced lupus. Indeed, about 15 to 30% of patients with subacute lupus have drug-induced lupus after long-term exposure. Some drugs are very associated with the risk of drug-induced lupus, such as terbinafine, antiepileptics, anti-TNF, and proton pump inhibitors. This is very important because treatment discontinuation is associated with the clearance of a skin lesion. A recent study published this year in Autoimmunity Review using the WHO database shown that among about 2,000 cutaneous drug-induced lupus, the author identified 94 drugs with a significant pharmacovigilance signal, and among them, which I think is very important, is that three prompt proton pump inhibitor, lansoprazole, omeprazole, and pantoprazole, were significantly associated with the risk of drug-induced lupus, and this is very important to identify and to search this drug in subacute lupus patients. Regarding the topical treatment, the European guidelines from CLE treatment recommended the topical corticosteroid and tacrolimus, as first-line treatments for local diseases. But as you can see in this figure in the paper published in psoriasis patients, the long-term adherence of topical treatment, lower than 10% in this study, is really abyssal. So I think you cannot use for long-term only topical treatments in moderate to severe disease. A small letter published in the JAMA Dermatology in 2015 suggested that topical tacrolimus at 0.3% may be associated with hair regrowth in cicatricial alopecia in 3 patients with an acceptable safety profile. However, we tried to use this topical treatment in our cohort among 8 patients. We did not observe hair regrowth, but it's not published for the moment. As you know, antimalarials, in particular hydroxychloroquine, are the first-line systemic treatment for CLE. The efficacy of hydroxychloroquine is demonstrated in a randomized phase 3 controlled trial. And as you can see here, after 16 weeks, the cutaneous response of patients treated with hydroxychloroquine was about 60%, compared with only 30% in patients treated with placebo. Antimalarials are recommended as first-line treatment in severe skin cutaneous lupus, as with a starting dose of 5 mg per kilogram of real body weight. This is important to highlight that this dose is not the dose associated with efficacy, but only with the risk of retinopathy, and in most of cases it is need to start with a dose of 400 mg per day. And for chloroquine, we use a starting dose of 200 or 250 mg per day. As you can see in this figure, the overall response rate of antimalarials is 63% with high differences between cutaneous subtype. In case of a failure of a first line of antimalarials, it is possible to add quinacrine to either hydroxychloroquine or chloroquine. Indeed, it is associated with an improvement of about 2/3 of patients. And there was a pharmacovigilance signal about the risk of aplastic anemia, which has not been confirmed in a large study of more than 500 patients published by the team of Victoria Verf in 2017. And also it is important to highlight the risk of yellow skin discoloration in patients treated with quinacrine. In case of persistent CLE activity with a first line of antimalarials, it is possible to measure hydroxychloroquine blood concentration, which can help to distinguish between poor adherence patients who have blood concentration lower than 200 nanogram per ml. And it is important to note that a threshold of 750 nanogram per milliliter is associated with CLE remission, and therefore it is possible to transitory increase hydroxychloroquine dose for 3 months, and which can improve CLE activity. It is also possible to switch from HCQ to CQ in patients with inefficacy. It is associated with about 50% of improvements, but this is mostly transitory. But it is also important to note that about more than 2/3 of patients with adverse events tolerated well second antimalarials. Regarding the prevalence of adverse events with antimalarials, the most severe adverse event is retinopathy, which need to follow the guidelines of the American Ophthalmology. And other adverse events include skin adverse events, in particular skin pigmentation. And it is also important to note that in most of cases, the discontinuation of treatment after hydroxychloroquine adverse event is not directly related to hydroxychloroquine using the French pharmacovigilance score. Among the second line or third line treatments, the European guidelines recommend three different types of treatments: methotrexate, retinoids, in particular acitretin, and dapsone. These recommendations are based on very limited data. Indeed, small randomized controlled trials showed that the efficacy was globally similar between hydroxychloroquine and acitretin, but with higher adverse events in the group treated with acitretin. In the largest case series published with methotrexate was a retrospective case series of 43 patients, but in this study the response rate was 98%, which is not what we observe in clinical practice. And finally, the dapsone may be interesting, in particular in patients with neutrophilic bullous lupus, but also may be interesting in patients with subacute lupus and discoid lupus. And it is important, this treatment is important in particular during pregnancy, because this is the only treatment which can be given during pregnancy. The Yoskel study group reported in 2013 the cutaneous response among more than 1,000 patients. And as you can see here, the response rate of methotrexate was rather 66% in this study, which is more close than the rate we observe in our practice. In this study, the efficacy of the mycophenolate mofetil was very impressive, and this treatment is maybe used in severe cutaneous lupus patients. Now let's talk about the thalidomide. Thalidomide is only recommended as the third line treatment in the European guidelines, but has been granted of a temporary recommendation for use in France as a second line treatment since 2015. In a literature systematic review from our group, including more than 500 patients, the overall response rate was about 90%, with a complete response rate of 66%, which is very impressive. The problem is that this treatment is only available at hospital pharmacy and has only suspensive efficacy, with relapse after discontinuation in more than 65% of patients. Moreover, it is associated with severe potentially adverse events, including teratogenicity and peripheral neuropathy, and thromboembolic risk, which is rare, but in 1 to 2% of patients. In our clinical practice, we start thalidomide at a dose of 50 mg per day, and we systematically add a low dose aspirin of 100 mg per day. And after cutaneous remission, we try to reach a minimal effective dose, because it is known that there is no peripheral neuropathy in using dose lower than 25 mg per day, and with a regular follow-up. Recently, lenalidomide, which is a thalidomide analog, had shown very promising efficacy. Indeed, in this study, including 40 CLE patients, including 35 previously treated with thalidomide, a 50% improvement of CLASI was observed in 88%, with a complete response in about half of patients. In this study, smoking was also associated with failure Regarding the safety profile, it seems that there is no neuropathy at the dose of 5 mg per day of lenalidomide, and there was no case of worsening of thalidomide-induced neuropathy, and therefore we use this treatment in case of thalidomide-induced neuropathy. However, there is a risk of arterial thrombosis such as with thalidomide using lenalidomide. Regarding the risk of SLE flare, in our study, 8 of the 26 patients with SLE has flared during the follow-up with a significant association with high SLEDAI score at baseline. Only one patient with CLE developed SLE during the follow-up. So we consider that this treatment has no effect on systemic feature of SLE, and that in case of severe SLE, it is important to have another treatment for systemic features. Now let's talk about the belimumab, which is an anti-BAFF monoclonal antibody, which is the first biologic approved in SLE. There is very few data regarding cutaneous involvement of SLE patients treated with belimumab, only a small series of 15 patients of an Italian cohort showing improvement of acute and subacute lupus patients. But there was no data about discoid lupus. This study among 16 refractory CLE patients, mostly discoid lupus, showed that at 6 months, half of patients had a 50% improvement of CLASI, including 3 complete response. But at last follow-up, 15 out of 16 patients discontinued belimumab, mostly because of persistent activity. Now, regarding the future of CLE, there was promising data about regarding ustekinumab, which is an anti-IL-12 and IL-23 inhibitor, and in a phase 2 study published in The Lancet, a 50% CLASI improvement was obtained in 64% of patients treated with ustekinumab compared with only 30% with placebo. However, there was no data regarding CLE subtype. However, Janssen announces discontinuation of the phase 3 study recently, so we will not have the results. The JAK inhibitors, in particular the baricitinib, recently showed efficacy compared with placebo in a phase 2 trial using the resolution of arthritis and rash SLEDAI score. The baricitinib at 4 mg per day showed better efficacy than placebo. However, no differences was observed using the CLASI score, and in my opinion, no conclusion can be drawn from this study, and the phase 3 study are needed to conclude. Maybe one of the most promising drugs for CLE or cutaneous involvement of SLE is anifrolumab, which is a monoclonal antibody binding to the subunit 1 of the type 1 interferon receptor. Two phase 3 studies were recently published. The TULIP-1 study was a negative phase 3 trials, but showing trends for CLASI improvement with a 42% improvement in the treated group compared with 25% in the placebo group. And the TULIP-2 study was published in the New England Journal of Medicine last year. And this was a positive phase 3 trial with also significant CLASI improvement with 49% improvement in the anifrolumab group compared with only 25% in the placebo, with a significant differences. Finally, I think one of the most promising strategy is depleting plasma sideroid dendritic cells in CLE. Here you have the data of a phase 1 trial of an anti-BDCA2 published in JCI in 2019, showing that depleting PDC is associated with depleting PDC in the skin and reduce interferon score, but also with the CLASI improvement. Moreover, an abstract was published last year in the American Congress of Rheumatology showing that in a phase 2 study involving 132 CLE patients, this treatment was associated with a significant CLASI activity reduction compared with placebo, and the phase 3 trial will be started soon and I think will be very promising. So this is all for today. I think I hope this talk may improve the management of this patient. Thank you very much for your attention.